Yeah, it's slightly different. So going from science to the arts. But what I wanted to do today was to share with you how the acquisition of the archive of Thomas Agnew and Sons and the art dealers has led to a number of collaborations, both with academia and with other institutions. But I also thought I wanted to start off with really about why we acquired the archive and how that acquisition fits within our overall strategy at the National Gallery. So I'm going to start with some contextual information about the strategic direction of the National Gallery and then move on to focus on the Agnew's archive itself. So there is the National Gallery in Trafalgar Square, established in 1824. And it houses the national collection of paintings in the Western European tradition from 1250 up to about 1900/1915, at which point Tate takes over the collecting responsibility. And the National Gallery has an overarching strategic framework for the whole organization. And really, this provides us with a plan that reflects our duty to protect the nation's paintings, to make them available to the public, and of course to add to them for future generations. And one key part of the plan is our ambition to give old master paintings a real central focus in modern cultural life. And while recognizing that at the moment we're in a very challenging funding environment that all arts institutions face and indeed local government faces as well, the framework identifies four key areas of activity that we still think we should strive to engage with. So I'll just put all four up there for you. Briefly, first one, preserve, enhance, and develop the potential of our collections for our public. So that embraces work in our scientific, conservation, and curatorial departments. It involves acquisitions, display, temporary exhibitions, that kind of thing. Then we have broadened our appeal and provide an exceptional visitor experience. That's not just about physical visitors coming into the gallery. It's also about how we reach out to people through the web and through social media, as we were hearing yesterday in one of the sessions. It's also about marketing and our new membership scheme that we've just recently launched. Then the third point there is inspire learning and engagement. That's not just traditional education activities, but also collaborations with academia, as I will talk about in a moment. And then finally, enhance effectiveness. That's really just making best use of our resources, but clearly an important point. So these four areas are really intended to guide everything that we do. And as I said, the third area of activity, the inspire learning and engagement, is the one that's most relevant to today's talk. But really, they all have an impact on what we do. And then within this kind of broad framework that applies to the whole gallery, we also have a more detailed research strategy. The research strategy, I think, is also an indication of a much more formal approach that the gallery is now taking towards research. Research has long been a part of the gallery's work, but in 2007 it instituted a new research committee to really monitor what we were doing and to guide what we were doing with research. And we are, of course, now recognised as an independent research organisation, which is a kind of academic analogue status by both the Arts and Humanities Research Council and the Engineering and Physical Sciences Research Council. So I think it's really important to recognise there's been a formalising of our approach to research, and that does have an impact on collecting activity, such as the acquisition of the Agnew's archives. So I think we like to do things in fours at the gallery. So we also have four research priorities. Very quickly, I'll go through these. Collections-based research, that's predominantly realized through the publication of scholarly catalogues about our collection that we still do publish in print format, actually, thanks to a very generous donation from a foundation. We also have exhibitions-related research. That's quite interesting because exhibitions can either initiate new research or they can be the result of existing research projects. research on conservation, on the environment in the galleries, on display, on access. It's fairly self-explanatory. And then again, another four, we have four National Gallery research themes, and that connects to Agnew's. But just going through them, the first one is called The Meaning of Making. So you can see there a painting being kind of micro-examined by a photo micrograph, and really this kind of builds upon a long-standing gallery tradition of collaboration within the gallery between the conservation, scientific, and curatorial departments, but also collaboration outside the gallery. It was interesting, I was listening to a talk yesterday about the Board of Trade papers, and we're talking about how you can look at science and how that can help with your research, and we certainly do that at the gallery as well. And really this aims to contextualize the technical study of paintings within the kind of wider art historical discourse, and certainly embraces collaborative work and numerous projects. Our second research theme is called Art and Religion. There we have St. Francis meditating by Zurbaran. And this strand really focuses in particular on the iconography and functions of Christian art, given the nature of the gallery's collection. And it builds on the success of recent exhibitions, such as Sacred Made Real or Devotion by Design. We have a number of collaborative doctoral students working in this area. And we also have a collaborative taught MA with the Department of Theology at King's College in London. Our third theme is the one that's relevant to Agnew's, is buying, collecting, and display, and it concentrates on the histories of the art market, as well as of taste, economics, and politics that lie behind the market. It's concerned with the audiences for art, including our own today, and also the history of the institution, and it was launched a few years ago, when we collaborated with the Getty Research Institute on a project looking at the 18th century art market in London. And then, I should say that's a portrait of Martin Colnaghi, who, of course, a famous art dealer in the 19th century. And then finally, we have the final research theme is the Centre for Venetian Art and its History. The gallery has one of the, if not the, most preeminent collections of Venetian art in the world. These are two recent acquisitions that we acquired jointly with National Galleries of Scotland. On the left, you can see Titian's Diana and Actaeon, and then on the right, Diana and Callisto. And so when we acquired these and we were talking to the National Galleries of Scotland, we also decided to set up this centre between the two of us. It's also a collaboration with Scotland, aiming to really position ourselves as a centre of excellence for the study of Venetian painting and its history. So there's a lot of research going on. There's just a few general examples in our conservation, scientific, and curatorial departments. And really, over the past few years, we've really been expanding our research activities through these kind of formal collaborations with higher education institutes, through seminars, lectures, conferences, and other formal or more informal, dissemination of research. And also through the increased presence of external researchers at the galleries. That can be the Collaborative Doctoral Award students, or it could be more senior visiting scholars. And so together with the permanent staff who are engaged in research at the gallery, it represents a significant body of activity. But where this differs from the past, and what I think is crucial to get across today, is that all of this is being done within a much more formal internal research structure at the gallery. And as part of this process, in order to give greater coherence to scholarly research at the National Gallery and to provide a platform for developing future work, especially collaborations and partnerships, in 2013, the gallery established a new research centre that, as well as encompassing the gallery's existing library and archive collections, also exists to accommodate current and future collaborative and external scholars and their activities, both improving the physical facilities available to them and helping to develop activities that allow researchers to communicate and exchange ideas. That could be through seminar series or academic conferences, that kind of thing. And so it's within this context that we acquired the Agnew's archive in February of this year. Thomas Agnew and Sons, of course, has a history dating back to 1817, and during the later 19th and early 20th century, it was one of the major London art dealers in old master paintings. And there you can see the archive in store. at the gallery. But why and how did this archive come to the National Gallery? Well, within the UK, there are major archives related to art, notably the Tate Archive and the Archive of Art and Design at the V&A. Tate, it has to be said, though, usually collects in the field of post-1900 art, and it does certainly collect dealer records in that area, but Agnew's wasn't really a fit for them. The Archive of Art and Design does collect in this area, but not so strongly in dealer archives. And we did, actually, when we were talking to Agnew's, we did get in touch with the V&A and others to explore where was the right home for this archive, and they were not interested in going down this road. So it was kind of left to the National Gallery, and of course, the Agnew's archive did fall clearly within our strategic research theme of buying, collecting, and display. So it certainly offered us a unique opportunity, I think, to establish ourselves as a major player in this field. The alternative would most likely have been a sale abroad, and that could, well, I think most probably it would have gone to the Getty Research Institute, or it could have gone to a well-funded university that was kind of seeking to establish its own credentials. And the acquisition came at a very opportune moment because it's also at the same time as a rapid growth of interest among the academic community in the history of the art market and the role of art dealers in the development of art history. And I think that can be seen as a consequence of several factors, and certainly academic inquiry into, say, new or under-researched areas. But I think it's really significant that it comes at a time when a number of major archives in this area have moved from the private business sphere into more publicly accessible repositories. So, for example, the Getty Research Institute, who own a huge number of dealer archives, notably Duveen and Goupil, have recently acquired, last year, 2013, the archive of the New York dealer, Noedler, a very, very important archive in this area. The Carnegie Archive, which was one of Agnew's major rivals in the late 19th century in London, has recently been placed on long loan to Wadsden Manor in their wonderful new Windmill Hill Archive Centre. And therefore, it's also very much more accessible. And finally, then, we have the Agnew's Archive being purchased by the National Gallery and now starting to be made more accessible. So I think we were fortunate that there was already a burgeoning community of interest in this field. But then, having acquired the Agnew's archive, we now wanted to make sure that we did increase its accessibility, and this is where we started to look to collaboration in order to develop and widen access to the archive collection, which of course then has a knock-on effect, helping us develop and widen access to the paintings collection. So there's sort of three things that I just want to run through. First of all, cataloguing. We managed to secure funding for cataloguing, a very generous grant from the John Murray Trust, and we're still looking to do more in this area. So it's a kind of fairly traditional commitment by the archive to increasing access. But as I said, we're also aware of the academic interest in this area, and it's certainly true that this movement of archives, I think, from the private to the public sphere, has resulted in a growing number of academic conferences on the subject of the art market, and also an increased level of collaboration between institutions in order to facilitate access to these disparate collections. So our first initiative was the second point there, to instigate two collaborative doctoral awards relating to the Agnew's archive. And we felt that encouraging this level of research would help open up the archive to others. The National Gallery is an independent research organisation, as I mentioned, and therefore we currently have three CDAs per year to award for collaborative doctoral research with universities, all managed via the AHRC. So these two on the Agnew's archive have just started this month, one with Liverpool University, which is looking at questions of connoisseurship and attribution with Agnew's and the National Gallery, and a second with Manchester University to investigate the role of the art market with regard to the gallery's acquisition strategy, with a particular focus, of course, on the relationship between the National Gallery and Agnew's, and both of them looking at that core period of activity in the old master art market of the late 19th and early 20th centuries. And I think that benefits all parties by not only helping us to find out more about the gallery's history and acquisitions, but also by promoting research among the academic community and leading to more engagement, and I think hopefully producing further research initiatives down the line. So that could take a form of a joint conference or research workshops or even a larger research project on the art market. But it's not just academic partners that we want to collaborate with, as I put at the bottom there, sort of cross-institutional initiatives, for want of a better phrase. We're also seeking to work closely with institutions like Wadston and particularly the Getty Research Institute to open up the archives digitally. The Getty Research Institute has already placed Goupil's stock books online, and it's now in the process of doing the same for Noedler. And so the gallery too is now looking at how we could digitize the Agnew stock books and place the data within them in a database that would help researchers trace works of art across the various dealers, in itself opening up new avenues of research for the academic community. But we do actually want to go beyond that. Although the collaboration with Getty is fairly informal at this stage, it does stem from a workshop that was held earlier this year, organized by the Getty, which was about bringing together those institutions with similar holdings. So that included obviously the Getty itself and the National Gallery, we were there, the Dutch Art Historical Institute, the Ercardé in The Hague, and the French equivalent in Achard in Paris, the Frick in New York, and others attended this workshop. And we started to think about how we can develop greater access to the archive resources. And it did make me think of yesterday, actually, we were talking about this idea of the sort of merchant seamen's records in one of the panels and linking together records held at the National Maritime Museum and at the National Archives in one place. Although, interestingly, our American colleagues are the same as yours, Jenny, because they are very keen on a kind of mega database that we all send the data into, and we're less keen on that, and we are also keener on things like open link data. So I don't know if there's a kind of transatlantic divide going on there. But we do want to see how we can link these. So not just have the databases and the digitized content online, and you can kind of link across to it, it's all very nice, but also by linking them together, because I think that will produce a much better result. I should say as well, something else that I think has come out of this conference is the need to embrace users, and we also had users at this workshop, so we had researchers and academics in the field to make sure that we were responding to a need and delivering something that would be useful. And I think hopefully by coming together to present our archive collections, we're going to be providing researchers with a much greater overall picture of the art market than would be possible acting on our own. And of course, all these dealers had massive relations with each other during the time. They would sell to each other, and works of art would go between one and the other. So it would be a great thing if we can link all this stuff up. We're also in sort of early days on this. Conversations are continuing, but it's certainly where we want to go. And so really just to kind of wind up, just to think about why it's important for the National Gallery to engage in this kind of research and to seek out these collaborations to help develop and widen access to the collections. Well, research has several clear roles, I think, in supporting the gallery's wider objectives, and particularly that one I mentioned at the start about sort of the ambition to get old master paintings there in modern cultural life. And it also enables us to position ourselves as a leading authority on the subject, but also to benefit from the latest knowledge and research in the field. And a research on an archive collection such as Agnew's is part of that bigger picture. And I think it was the development of a clear research strategy that enabled us to acquire an archive such as Agnew's that was possibly in danger of leaving the UK. I mean, I'm not too bothered about that. It ends up at the Getty. It's still in a public repository. But, you know, it did allow us to preserve it in the place where it had functioned as a business for so long. And it's also now allowing us to seek to maximize the possibilities for knowledge exchange at a national and international level. And so in developing collection-based collaborations and in opening up these collections, I think what I've really learned from the gallery's experience as being of the greatest importance is that you have to have some sort of strategic vision. And I don't think we did have that in the past. I think going back 10 years before we became an independent research organization, that really forced the gallery to think more about how it was going to frame its research activities. We always did research, but we never really had a structure within which it operated, and we never really had a strategy within which it operated. And I think that's the most important thing that I've learned from this, that having that formal structure developed from being an IRO has allowed us to have a framework within which we could acquire the Agnews archive. And I think it's now helping us to open that up to a wider audience through the various collaborations that I've mentioned. And thank you very much for listening.